Dr. Sherry Vaughan, 1870 to 1905. I helped people, even if they couldn't pay me. Everybody in town came to me. I couldn't save everybody like I wished I could. I had one patient, his name was John Haydock. I didn't think there was any chance of him living. When he came to me, his face was pale. He was weak with a fever. Standing there shaking, he had influenza. He laid in his beds for weeks. And I went to his house every day, bringing hot chicken soup and piling more blankets on him as he shivered. After a couple more weeks, he finally died. No more misery. But then the unthinkable happened. I was never concerned about myself. As I laid in my bed, saying my goodbyes to my husband, my beloved husband, as he sat by my side, tears running down his face, saying, "I will see you again someday," as I left this world forever because of the thing I love to do.
Mike Notwell, 1873 to 1907. I was the first one to join the Dynamite team at the Rita Fay Mine. And then came five more men, and they nominated me as a team leader, even though I was a joker. When we got to the back of the mine, my eyes instantly hit the case of sweating dynamite. We got all set up, and we had some left over. I wiped my finger along the side and snapped it to the ground. When it snapped, everybody screamed, then laughed. I did it again, only that time it hit the fuse. The smell of gunpowder filled the air. We all watched as the red and orange sparks started racing down the fuse. We all ran. Then it came. The shaft lit up like the campfire we made that morning. The blast was like being hit by a clear locomotive. And the shockwave caved in the tunnel. And now six lifeless bodies lay under a pile of smoking rock. And it was all my fault.
Rex Martin, 1875 to 1907. I was born in Grand Encampment, the only child of a poor miner. My mother passed away from pneumonia. I then watched over my father, who had influenza, from being in the cold, damp mines. I took his place in the caves when the boom started. As the boom progressed, my father passed away. He left me his tools. One day in the mine, me and Mike's crew went to test some dynamite. Something happened on the second test. Suddenly, I saw a bright orange burst of color suddenly appear. Seconds later, a burning sensation filled my body as I watched the rest of the crew fall one by one.
Ashley Herring, 1889 to 1919. My mother and father died when I was just 16, leaving me to care for my two siblings. We barely made it, but through love and faith, we survived. The Template Cafe hired me out of pity. Then the miners began to arrive. Business was thriving, my pay was raised, the town boomed. I married a miner with eyes as wide and blue as the ocean. And God blessed me with four beautiful children. However, sickness began to spread. My family worried I'd die from influenza, and they would live without a mother, a sister, a wife. My skin turned pale, I coughed up blood, I felt feverish and knew what the outcome would be. I collapsed on the old wooden floor of the Tin Plate Cafe. I can see them now with puffy, tear-filled eyes. My family grieves for me.
Amelia Wolford, 1907 to 1927. I was the second school teacher in Encampment. My father built the building for my seven siblings and I so we could be educated. But only Adrian and I stayed in the growing town after my father passed in his sleep 17 years later. I became the new teacher, and Adrian became a rancher and businessman. I loved my job and was loyal to the children. A productive citizen was I. Teaching, sewing, singing in the church choir every Sunday. In 1926, Adrian started a 4-H club. I was all in when I heard, convincing the children to join. In the early spring of 1927, the snow not yet melted, she came. Violet was pretty and smart, and I enjoyed her company every Sunday at the Tin Plate Cafe for lunch after church. One day, I ordered the usual, but my tea tasted odd. I thought we were friends until that fateful afternoon. A sudden heaviness filled my body as I staggered to the door. I fell on the floor, seemingly asleep, but never woke up.
Violet Roman, 1908 to 1931. When I came to Grand Encampment, I had a dream of becoming a teacher, but Amelia Wolford got the job because her dad built the schoolhouse. She is the reason I worked at the Tin Plate Cafe. Fearing I'd lose my job because of the stock market crash, I had to find a way to get rid of her. Every Sunday after church, she came in and had a glass of tea. I made her think I was her friend, but really the smile on my face hid the hatred I had for her. One Sunday, she came in with a smile on her face. I kindly smiled back with hate in my eyes. When she ordered her glass of tea, she didn't know that this time I had added a little something extra. Nobody knew the real reason she dropped dead in the middle of Tin Plate Cafe that Sunday afternoon.
Just one thing I noticed is try to keep your legs, try to stand still.
Okay.
Because you're doing, and you're...
Okay.
And it's hard, I know.
Yeah.
Like that, just that, like what you just did, that's what you were doing.
Okay. William Herring, 1895 to 1937. I came to Grand Encampment with a wife, a toddler, and another on the way. After the boom, to get a lot of cheap land, I scavenged up 3,000 acres. That meant a lot to me. The mountainous hills, the trees were beautiful. I woke up to the river every morning. I bought 300 head of cattle and started to make a living. Things couldn't be better. I just bought a tractor in 1919 and that made life a heck of a lot easier. Till one day I saw some cows were missing. I went out one night to find some cattle rustlers. I snuck up on them. They looked very surprised when they had been caught. Me and my gun told them to stop. They figured the only way to get out of this alive was to drop my cows and quit bothering me. They never bothered me again. I was starting to get old and couldn't do everything I used to do. I told my two kids to keep care of Mama and to keep doing what I had started. I went to bed a couple nights later, feeling very happy and thankful for what I had been given. I fell asleep to never wake up again.
Bruce West, 1883 through 1922. I never grew up around horses until I moved west with my brothers. One of the first homesteaders around encampment, breaking horses for money, living every day in the saddle where I belonged. Each horse was a different story. The worst horse was Outlaw. After that, I became the Horse Whisperer. Up to 50 horses a year, I kept busy all year long. I met my wife giving a horse back to her father. We had two boys and one daughter. One day, I was riding Outlaw's daughter. A gunshot went off not too far away. The horse spooked. I fell off and got caught in the stirrup and was dragged and stomped to death.
Richard Baker, 1860 to 1922. I owned the Bar 13, just a small bar where people would come to get a quick drink. When the copper boom started, my bar filled every night with drunks. My concoctions were selling like hotcakes. The more people that came for the boom, the more people came to my bar after a hard day's work. For every miner that entered my bar, the more money flew into my register. Being drenched in sweat and dirt, and the smell of alcohol added, the stench of the miners was as bad as cow patties, and they were not quiet. Every night, miners were shouting and the clink of glasses could be heard. But then came the prohibition. 30 years of hard work only after shut down my business. With nowhere to go, I quickly started to starve. And with a smile across my face, I died.
Damon Blake, 1868 to 1889. It was 2 years ago when I moved to the wonderful place of Encampment, Wyoming. No one bothered me and no one talked to me. For all of my 21 years, I had not a single friend to call my own. I didn't even have a family anymore. Life had been really lonely. All I had was a boss, a gun, and a job. My boss provided me with a bright new Winchester 33, and he was always strapped by my side. It was Friday night, and Ale was calling my name. Why did I listen? Every night drinking wasn't helping any. And then boom, my body dropped with force to the cold floor. But the suffering was over, and one last tear dripped from my cheek.
Adelie, 1898 to 1995. I only know why my brother has vanished. Countless times, the memory playing while I lie here in guilt. He repeatedly shushing me to keep it kept as the tears ran down onto the floor. My only brother was my best friend. If only my mother had known of the horrible man he was. I have been asked many times. I was young and may have seen. But knowing I couldn't say, and if I had, I would be gone. 1906, my brother went missing. The copper boom brought 4,000 people in 15 bars. If only my father had not been drunk, he would not have shot, killed, and buried the body of my only brother. But I only know.
West Notwell, 1885 to 1910. We moved to Grand Camp for the copper and joy. I worked as a blacksmith, helping people year-round and loving what I did. My apprentice, his name was John Smith. He made nails for houses, I made tools for ranchers and pickaxes for miners. When John was done with his final nail, he pierced it through the wood for a hook, but the nail was crooked. I hung my shears on it above my head. The rest was a blur. Nails, like people, are straight, but rarely is there one that is crooked.